Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Calvary Church. My name is Bo Eckert, and whether you're joining us in person, online, or by radio, we're so glad that you're with us today. We want you to feel welcomed, and we would love to connect with you. If you have questions or you're looking to take a next step here at Calvary, there are several ways that you can do that. First, you can simply scan the QR code that's here on the screen or in your bulletin in order to fill out our digital Connect card. Whether this is your first time here, or you want to know more about Calvary, or if you've been here and are looking to take a next step, this is a great way to start that conversation. As we're about to begin the fall ministry cycle, there are some great opportunities to serve in guest services, student ministry, and Calvary Kids. You can use the QR code to begin that conversation as well. You can also stop by the Overlook in the center of our lobby immediately following this service, where a few staff and volunteers will be available to connect with you in person for any and all of these opportunities. At the end of today's service, our care team will be available at the front of the auditorium to pray with you for any specific needs that you have. If you're tuning in live on our website, there is a host available to connect and pray with you, so take advantage of the live chat and prayer features while you're tuning in. With the fall right around the corner, there are many great events happening and ministries that are about to get started. We can't mention every opportunity on a Sunday morning, so our weekly Life at Calvary email is the best way to stay informed and up to date. But I do want to take a moment to highlight three upcoming events for you right now. First, our student ministries is hosting our outdoor baptism event tonight at 6 p.m. All are welcome to attend and hear stories of life change as 10 of our students take their next steps of obedience in their pursuit of life in Christ. This will be held around the back of the church by the gym and student ministry entrances. On Sunday, August 28th at 3 p.m., we'll be hosting a hymn sing. Mark your calendar and join us in the chapel for this time of worship through song. And finally, Calvary Family Night is coming up on Wednesday, August 31st. Come anytime after 5 p.m. for dinner in Fellowship Hall. We'll transition just before 6:30 to programming for children while the rest of the church heads to the auditorium for our annual congregational meeting. Afterwards, we'll all come back together for dessert. Please visit our website to RSVP so we can plan well for the meal and the kids' programming. In preparation for the vote to affirm our new elder and deacon candidates during the annual meeting, the bios for each of the candidates are available at the Connection Centers and at calvarychurch.org/bios. Now, no matter what might be happening in your life, we have the opportunity to focus our minds and our hearts together on God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ as we worship Him now through song.
Well, that's true. That's why we are here together, and that's to worship our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Dave Ross. Whether you're in the room or joining us online, as Bo said, we're just so happy to be able to join together and to worship God. And we've been learning a new song that we're going to do in just a minute, and that song declares the truth that we see in Romans chapter 8, when it says, "If God is for us, who can be against us? Who is to condemn? For Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ?" That is what we gather together for, and that is why we're here. So let's stand together, let's sing, and declare those words together. Even when I stumble, even when I fall, Well, thank you so much for engaging with that song, You May Have a Seat. We are so excited, as I said earlier, to be able to gather week after week to worship God through singing, through praying together, through giving, and also through hearing testimony of what God is doing in the lives of those among us. As Pastor Bo said in the announcements, this evening we have our outdoor baptism hosted by student ministry, and we want to invite you to that because it's going to be a celebration of 10 students declaring their faith in Christ and that they are following Christ. And this morning we get a little bit of a precursor to that. This morning in this service we're going to witness the baptism of Tyson Mitchell. And he is another student who is declaring that he follows Jesus. And if you're new to the faith or new to Calvary, baptism is a public declaration, an outward declaration of something that's true inward. And that's trusting in Jesus Christ for forgiveness of our sins and trusting that we have new life in him because of his resurrection from the dead. And so that is what baptism is. It's a public declaration, and when we witness together and hear testimony, we can celebrate what God is doing. So before we celebrate with Tyson and watch him be baptized, we want you to hear his testimony. So let's watch and listen together.
My name is Tyson Mitchell. I grew up in Lancaster my whole life. I started attending Calvary in about third grade. Both my parents are believers. I have two siblings, Jordan and Trey. I graduated Warwick High School this year, and next year, or this fall, I'll be attending Erskine College to pursue business and golf. I always grew up in a church. Both my parents were very adamant about going to church every Sunday and just making sure I knew what the gospel was. And so when I was about five, I was ready to make the decision. And so I sat down with my parents in their room and we prayed. And I accepted God into my heart and he saved me from all my sins. I chose to be saved because I knew I needed to get free of my sin, and the only way to do that is to through the power of God. And so he died on the cross for my sins, and I knew I needed to follow him. I started coming to Calvary in third grade, and third grade on, I was just basically going through the motions. Parents said had to go to church, and until about going into my junior year, I really didn't even understand really what was going on. I was just going to church going to church almost as like a checkbox. And so going into my junior year, I started asking deeper questions, asked Alex, kind of just learning more about faith, like learning why I was sinning so much, what, like going through some of my struggles. And from that point on, like I started taking my faith more seriously. So beginning of my junior year, Alex and I, Alex started pushing me to read my Bible. And so that was something I never did growing up. And I was always told to, but I just never did. That was one of my biggest struggles. And so then I started reading my Bible more, and it really opened up my eyes just to see how powerful it was and how much change it brought into my life. And I think the student group was crucial, just my leaders and the guys in my student group just being there with me every week from seventh grade on. It was just kind of cool just to have them and just keep us accountable, keep me and the guys in my group accountable. And then meeting with Alex every week, and he was able to disciple me my junior and senior year. And then I got the opportunity to disciple the seventh grade boys, being a leader for them. And that was just kind of cool because I kind of knew what it was like to be a seventh grader. It was cool that I was able to be discipled by Alex, and now I get to pour into their lives and just be able to tell them what I learned and give them experiences that I was able to go through. My favorite verse is Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. I've always liked this verse. This verse has meant a lot to me, and anytime I had a struggle or anything like that, it was just kind of cool to know that like God was there, God was with me, and through him all things are possible. And I'm being baptized today because all through my life, I mean, no one would know I'm a believer, but now I'm publicly declaring that I'm a believer and that this is how I want to live my life and I want to live for God.
Well, my name is Alex Bachter. I'm the high school director here at Calvary, and I've had the special privilege of getting to know Tyson over the last 2 years. And Tyson, it's been an absolute honor to be used by God in this way in your life, and to see your steps of obedience has been incredible. And so I have a question for you. Do you believe that Christ died on the cross for your sins and rose again, conquering death, so that the only way you can be with God forever is through Christ.
Yes.
Then based on your testimony of faith, I baptize you today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Well, amen. It is awesome to hear the testimony of Tyson, and we really encourage you to come back this evening to hear a testimony of 10 more of our students. But did you notice the way that God was faithful in Tyson's life? Did you notice the things he mentioned? He mentions his parents, and he mentions his small group, and Alex, who baptized him, who discipled him. And he mentioned the Word of God, that reading his Bible built his faith. God was faithful through all those ways, and then he was faithful through Tyson. And that's what he calls us to. As we continue to walk with him, that we would see his faithfulness and be part of his faithfulness in the lives of those around us. And maybe you're praying for somebody right now that needs to hear or know the faithfulness of God. Maybe you're a parent praying for your child. Maybe you're praying for a sibling or a spouse or a friend who needs to know the love of Jesus Christ. Maybe you yourself are wrestling with your faith. And the next song we're going to sing has an awesome line in it that says, "You shine in the shadows." I want us to pray now that we would be people that help the Lord shine into the shadows, that if we have shadows that the Lord needs to shine into, that we would leave them at his feet, that we would lift up those in our lives who need to know the loving, saving grace of Jesus Christ, that he would shine in the shadows of our lives and others. Let's pray together. Lord, we lift that request up to you as your people. We ask that you would shine in the shadows of our lives and others, that you would show your faithfulness through us, in us, and around us, Lord, because it brings you glory, because you are made known through it. And so we ask that your Spirit would continue to work in us to make us more like you day after day, and that we would be moldable and teachable. And Lord, we pray that you would be glorified in all of it. And we pray that in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing a song that declares that, and declares that the place that we start is in prayer. The place that we begin for anything, any request, is to go to the Lord. So let's stand together now and let's sing that together.
Jesus.
the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Sing it out.
Nothing can stand against the power.
You shine in the shadows. You win every
that together. We sing that truth together, that you are faithful. That every step we're breathing your grace in and out, Lord. And Lord, we want to declare your praise forever and ever. And we want to declare your glory and give you all the honor, because you're the one who walks with us and you're the one who works in us through your Spirit. We pray that to be true of us. We pray that we would be moldable and shapeable and intentionally following after you in our lives, so that we will declare your gospel through our words, through our actions, and through our lives. We praise you, Jesus, and we pray it in your name. Amen. You may be seated, and children are dismissed for Kids Church.
Good morning. My name is George May. I'm pastor of Counseling and Family Ministries here at Calvary. And it's my privilege to share with you this morning on this topic of a parent after God's own heart. And I hope I didn't just lose three quarters of you. I know that many of you are not parents. Many others of you no longer have children in the home. But I would ask you to stick with me, because the principles we'll be talking about this morning are relevant to pretty much any relationship in which you desire to have influence, whether extended family or discipleship relationships or other relationships around you. So I trust God will help you to apply it to the context in which you find yourself. Well, it's been a while since I've been up here. Some of you may not have even seen me before, so let me introduce myself. This is my family. Some of you are laughing. Yes, although this feels like 5 or 6 years ago, it's actually 17 years ago now. That's at Acadia National Park at the top of Beehive Trail, a trail that was much more of a cliffside narrow trail than we recognized when we started on that with these young kids. And so we were very, very careful. At times they had to hold on to metal rungs because it was so narrow, and we made sure they had the right footholds. We got them up to the top safely, and that they were so proud of it. They were just fueled a love for adventure and outdoors for them. About 5 years ago, we redid that northeast trip and did Beehive again just for old time's sake, and then went on up to do Mount Katahdin, which is the northernmost part of the Appalachian Trail. We came into Mount Katahdin from the north side, so we had to come across Knife's Edge and down and up the chimney, which is a very steep, almost straight-up scramble. This time, it was our children who were making sure we had the right handholds and footholds and that we made it up safe. And so it was a very profound moment where we recognized the generational shift in our family. And just 2 months ago, our youngest moved out. We are now true empty nesters. So that's pretty wild. This is our family now. My wife Linda and I, there on the left, have been married for 32 years. Nathan and Jesselyn, our younger two, both live in the area. You'll see Jesselyn around here at Calvary Church. And then Carissa on the far right is our oldest daughter, along with our son-in-law Patrick and our grandbaby Aspen, whom we love dearly. And you'll notice that she is expecting. In fact, my wife is working her way out to Pittsburgh right now. We got a call this morning that things might be going on. So we're excited about that, and we are even more excited, honestly, that our kids are walking with the Lord, and we're just grateful for God's work in their lives. You know, we have a lot of great memories, memories that bring smiles and laughter and warm our hearts. And then there are the cringe memories, Some fun cringe memories, you know, the things the kids keep bringing up that you did that was really dumb. Like on the Snake River, rafting the Snake River, when I didn't think we should get out here because it didn't look like where we put in, one of my kids brilliantly said, "Dad, this isn't an amusement park ride. It doesn't go around in a circle and we don't get out where we put in." But then there are those more significant cringe memories. If you're empty nesters, you know what I mean. I have those times where I just wish I could go back and have a do-over. A season of life where my time was out of balance. Or those moments of parenting when, despite my genuine and true love for my children, the reactions of my own heart created damaging interactions. Parenting has taught me a lot about my own heart. Parenting has taught me a lot about God. I hope this morning we can just take a step back and talk about what healthy parenting or any healthy relationship looks like and learn more about our hearts and learn more about our God. We're in this sermon series about the life of David, where we're really seeking to know better the God of David. For the last 2 weeks, we've looked at David's sin against Bathsheba and how he tried to cover it up by murdering her husband. We saw his deep, heartfelt repentance in Psalm 51. And we took a look at the great joy that he had in the completeness of God's forgiveness in Psalm 32. God fully forgave David and fully restored him. He fully confessed, "I have sinned against the Lord," and God restored him. But there were still consequences for David. God said, "Now therefore the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against you out of your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor. And he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son." David faced a lot of consequences for his sin. The baby born to Bathsheba died as an infant. His oldest son, Amnon, and I would guess presumed heir to the throne, committed sexual sin like his father did. He raped his sister-in-law, his half-sister. Absalom, another brother, was so angry that he came and he killed Amnon. A few years later, Absalom tried to take over the kingdom from David, drove David out of Jerusalem, just like God said, "I'll raise up evil against you out of your own house. He will lie with your wives in the sight of this son." Part of what Absalom did to establish himself as king was to take David's wives and sleep with them on the roof of the palace. Absalom, too, was slain by the sword by David's army. And then late in David's life, Adonijah also tried to take over the kingdom, and he also was slain by the sword. I can't imagine David's heartache, seeing the pain of his daughter who had been raped, grieving over the loss of his sons. And it appears that because of his own sin, he may have stepped back from actively parenting during those years. And so, seeing the significance of all of this, those who put together this sermon series said, this is probably a good time for us to take a step back and really look at this significant issue of parenting. Well, David had other sons and daughters too, some of which followed the Lord, like King Solomon. And Solomon wrote this verse about parenting that is often misunderstood. It says, "Train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it." Taken as a statement of fact, that's a little bit confusing, isn't it? I mean, David had sons and daughters who followed God and sons and daughters who didn't, right? So, did he parent them differently? Or how do we understand David's best friend, Jonathan, who probably had the most impeccable character of anyone in 1 and 2 Samuel. But Jonathan was raised by King Saul, an angry and violent and power-hungry man. Which, by the way, should be an encouragement to any who have been raised in dysfunctional homes. God can take you and make you a man and woman after God's own heart with that impeccable character of Jonathan. Nothing's too big for God to overcome. But this is not only confusing, it can also be condemning. If we take this as a promise, well, I've had a lot of parents in my office saying, "What did we do wrong that my children walked away from the Lord?" Well, and the first answer is probably a lot. We all did, right? We've all messed up a lot in our parenting. And we need to own that. We need to make it right with our kids. We need to keep growing. But the underlying assumption there is an error. I mean, the reality is our kids are not computers where if we program in the right code, they'll run exactly the way they're supposed to. I mean, even Adam and Eve that lived in a perfect relationship with God the Father disobeyed God and walked away from him. And so we need to recognize that this is not a promise. So it's not, you know, if we understand it as a proverb, it's more encouraging and not so condemning. If we understand it as a proverb, it means it's a general principle, something that's generally true. It's a wisdom statement. I think we all recognize that healthy homes emotionally and spiritually and relationally are a much better foundation for which our children to build a life of following the Lord and pursuing life in Christ and doing well in every area of life. So we don't have control, but we have huge influence as parents. We need to use that responsibility well. Well, having found no strategies from David's life for parenting, let me share with you our favorite strategy for parenting. Just kidding, just kidding. They were only having fun. You mandated reporters can stick your phones back in your pocket. But it is important for us to have good strategies for parenting. Strategies that are biblically based, that are heart-focused, and that are really practical in nature. And we teach a lot of courses here with that goal in mind. In fact, the next one is coming up in October. You'll see some information on it in your bulletin. And that one is on creating a culture of honor in your family. So if you still have kids in the home, we'd love to see you there. But today we're focusing on the foundational elements of parenting, not so much the specific strategies. We're going back to the basics. If you walk away from today and say, "Well, I didn't learn anything new," you've kind of missed the main point. What I really want this to be is an honest reevaluation of our hearts and an honest reevaluation of our parenting. And the first foundational principle I want to talk about is that we should be focused more on relationship than on immediate results. I think we all know that when our kids are young, the fastest way to get them to do what we want to do is to threaten a harsh consequence or be a little angry or give a stern look. But when that's part of the normal pattern in a family life, it tears at relationship and we damage relationship, and ultimately we end up losing a lot of influence. And perhaps worst, we model to our kids that God the Father is an angry God. We don't want to do that. The prophet Zephaniah talks about God's disposition towards his people. And I want to take a look at it. He says, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save." We've been singing about that all morning, right? We don't walk alone. God is with us. God is for us. Can you take that in, that is true of God's heart toward you? And look at these parental images. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love, just like a mother might quiet a baby. He will exalt over you with loud singing. Amazing images of God's pleasure in his people, of God's love for his people, that God is with us, that God is for us, that God cares about us. I think one of the most amazing things about this passage for me is that it is actually written in the context of God's correction of Israel. Israel is not following God as this is expressed to Israel. Even in times when we're not doing the right thing, this is still God's heart toward us. He's with us. He's for us. He takes pleasure in us. See, God is not an indifferent, distant deity that reacts in anger and just turns his back on us when we fail. Scripture says God is slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness and faithfulness and grace. Ultimately, our goal as parents is to model that and point our children to their heavenly Father and the one who is ultimately their faithful one and the one who will save. Notice there are not only verbal ideas here, there are nonverbal ideas. One of the things I really love is to watch Patrick and Carissa with their baby Aspen. They'll walk in the door and, "Hi, Aspen!" And Aspen's face just lights up. And Aspen knows she's loved and knows that they love to be with her. And, you know, I mean, as kids get older, you know, we're not going to walk into a room with a teenager and say, "Hi, Carissa!" You know, that'd be a little odd. But what do our nonverbals display to our kids? Is there a warm greeting? Are there smiles? Is there pleasure that they can see that we take in them? Or has the busyness of life made those greetings rather perfunctory? Or worse yet, has the wear and tear of parenting created the normal being just kind of a stern look? What do we communicate to our kids through the nonverbals? When we do this well and our kids know that we are with them and for them and take pleasure in them, it creates a secure relationship. And from a secure relationship, it's safe for them to be vulnerable with us about the stuff that's going on in their hearts that we want to talk to them about anyway as parents. But for angry like it, that's not safe for them to open up. I mean, we're going to mess up, but when we mess up, we've got to repair the relationship quickly to really maintain that relationship of love and trust with our children. Well, that kind of relationship really takes time. It takes time together with our kids to have fun and just to do life. I suspect that King David, as well as the priests of his day, Samuel and Eli, who all of their kids walked away from the Lord, I suspect maybe they spent a little bit too much time at the office. You know, God's work, issues of national importance. But doesn't our culture press us into that frenetically busy lifestyle too? And you know it, when we're chronically rushed, we are far more reactive in our parenting. We're unavailable for those unexpected relationship opportunities with our kids or with others. And we have far less time to truly nourish relationships. So we really need to work hard at our pace of life to make sure that we have margin in our time so that when there are those unexpected opportunities for ministry to kids, to others, we are available and can be responsive. When the challenges are truly out of our control, and with some it is. I mean, I can't imagine being a single parent responsible for all parenting duties and working full-time. And like, it must be overwhelming. Or families that have children with physical needs or disabilities, there's a lot of extra that goes into that. And, you know, that's where it's okay to reach out for help. I mean, extended family, the church family, we need to be there to help carry a burden that's too big for people to carry alone. But I think it's important for us to step back and ask about our pace of life. Are we available? Are we available when those moments arise? It also takes this relational focus not only takes time, it takes a strong walk with God. That we really take in the depth of God's love for us. That we really think about how God views our kids, asking Him to help us to view them and have the same heart to them as He has. So that when we engage with conversation, it's an overflow of God's love in our hearts. Well, the second foundational principle is that we need to focus on discipleship more than discipline. Well, discipline is important, don't get me wrong, but even discipline should be in the context of discipleship with a forward-looking, for their growth idea, not you committed a crime, here's your punishment. Let's take a look at how God's heart is towards discipline, as the writer of Hebrews says in chapter 12. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves for our good, that he may share in his holiness. And it later yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. That's God's heart towards us when he corrects us and disciplines us. And discipline isn't pleasant at the time, but he desires that it forms us and grows us. Is that what our children experience, even in unpleasant correction of them? Do they see that heart for them? Proverbs 15:31 says, whoever heeds life-giving correction will be at home among the wise. And so, for parents, I ask you, is your correction life-giving? Or is it potentially reactive and damaging? To those of you under your parents' instruction, I ask you, just what is God's purpose in their correction of you? Whoever heeds life-giving correction will be at home among the wise. Those who disregard discipline despise themselves, but whoever heeds correction gains understanding. I challenge you to ask God to use the correction that your parents give you to help you gain wisdom and understanding, and understand that even though your parents mess it up a lot of the times and you know, make mistakes, that their heart is truly for you and for your best. And understand, too, there's a warning here. If we disregard the biblical instruction and correction that our parents give us, we are in for some damage in the future as we just go our own way. Well, good life-giving instruction at the time of correction is important, but our teaching has to go beyond that. It's much more difficult to step back and look at the big picture of our children's lives and say, what is it that they must be thinking? What are the motives that are driving their hearts? What are the issues that they're facing right now? It takes good listening. It takes a lot of thinking. It takes a lot of planning. And then we can address those issues maybe in indirect ways in family devotions, or maybe in very direct ways in one-on-one conversations that are totally outside the context of discipline. I want you to take a look with me at Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7. As Moses speaks to all of Israel, and he's talking about God's words and God's commands. And he says, you shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. Notice the word diligently there. This is to be purposeful and regular. It's to be a normal part of life that we talk about God and the things that God has done and the work that he's doing in our lives. It's to be a normal part of life that we talk about God's ways and God's truth and the path to life. Now, this does take place at church, and I just want to take a moment to thank you profusely to every one of you who built into the lives of my children in student ministries and children's ministries. This church had an unbelievable impact on my kids. Thank you. Thank you. And I just want to say, too, thank you for those of you that continue to build into the lives of the children and youth here. What a significant ministry. But to you parents, I want to say, yes, use the church to help. Partner with the church. But we as parents are the primary disciplers of our children. And teaching them diligently is so important. I think one of the biggest, saddest parenting verses in all of Scripture is one that comes about three or four generations of this. After Moses says, teach these things diligently to your children. And by the way, two chapters earlier, he says to your children and your children's children. So this is for you grandparents too, for us grandparents too. But in Judges, three or four generations later, when Joshua died and all the elders who outlived Joshua died, it said that there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. What happened to that teaching? And it says that Israel abandoned the Lord and everyone did what was right in his own eyes. This diligent teaching is so important for our children and for the generations to come. There's a lot at stake. Well, as we look at the context of Deuteronomy 6, verse 7, where he says, teach them diligently, I think it's important that we see the verses right in front of it, because there might be something more important than our correction and our teaching. Moses starts by saying, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. And you shall teach them diligently to your children. Part of discipleship is modeling a life of faith and love for God. I wonder if we asked your children, or if you would ask mine, based on their lives, what do your parents value? What would they say? Would they say loving God, living out God's word, growing with God's people? Would they say a life of service, reaching out to others? Or are those just our Sunday morning values? Would they be able to see God's character reflected in our parenting? Would they see God's love reflected in our marriage? Never too early to start with that. Just a quick commercial. We've got a new group of marriage builders starting on September 11th. And if you're engaged or newly married or you know someone that is, it's a great place to go to build that solid foundation of marriage, which is a super important thing for a solid foundation for parenting. There's more in your bulletin about that. But we need to step back and ask, do others around us, do our children see that our pursuing life in Christ affects every area of our life? How we handle our finances, how we use our time, how we deal with our material things, our work, our family life, our other relationships. And of course, again, there's a lot of places for us to grow. And so part of this modeling growth is acknowledging when we mess up, asking forgiveness. Do our children see our growth and our change? Do they see us pursuing life in Christ? And that really brings us to our third foundational principle, to focus on my growth before my child's growth. What do I mean by that? Well, I think good parenting starts with the heart of the parent, not the latest strategy or the latest book. In Proverbs 4:23, Solomon says, above all else, guard your heart, because everything you do flows from it. All of our words and our actions and our reactions come from it. That means that when our children do the wrong thing and they're disobedient or disrespectful and we react and get angry. Oh, man. Why is there water on the floor? One of you is going to say, because you knocked the cup over, dummy. There's another reason. It's because there was water in the cup. What if there was dirty motor oil in there or acid? We'd have a lot more damage and a lot more cleanup to do. It's a great illustration of our parenting. When the disobedience, the disrespect, or the irresponsibility of our kids knock our hearts, what pours out? It's easy for us to say, well, I wouldn't have been angry if my kids wouldn't have... No. Solomon makes it very clear. What comes out is from our heart. And when we try to blame our kids for our reaction, we totally lose credibility. We lose influence. We lose relationship, and we lose an opportunity to grow ourselves. So when our kids act out, what do they see coming out of our hearts? This is a focus on our growth first. Do they see the water, the pure water of life-giving correction, or do they see reactive things that can cause damage to the relationship? There are a lot of issues that can cause our hearts to react in unhealthy ways. And when we do react in unhealthy ways, we need to step back and say, what's going on here for me? The first one, and by the way, I have seen every one of these at some point in my parenting career, I'm sad to say. But probably the one I face most in the counseling office is this one. Control and respect. The demand for children to respect and obey. It's a good desire, but a lousy demand. Have any of you ever caught yourself saying, "You will not talk to me that way"? Is that really helpful to our kids? Or is that about my heart and my pride being offended that my kids talk to me that way? Or how about this one? Yelling at our kids, telling them that they shouldn't yell at their siblings or yell at us. Yeah, that's a good one, right? We've all been there. Modeling, by the way, if we recall, is an important part of discipleship. And so, you know, it's so important for us to be careful about what's coming out of our heart, that we not demand the control and respect and think it's okay for us to react based on that. Maybe a better way to handle it when our kids' disrespect or disobedience, you know, pushes on our heart is to step back, give them a break so that they can calm down, but really take a break so that we can calm down. Talk to the Lord. God, fill me with your heart for my child. Help me to see them through your eyes. I surrender this demand for my own pride to be satisfied here. Just, you know, and then go back to our kids and say, you know, maybe say to a teenager, "Look, Sam, I am sorry. I was really wrong. I should not have yelled at you that way. There's no excuse. I was hurt by the way you talked to me, but, you know, the important thing here really is that you grow up into a person whose heart is really characterized by respect for others. And like, it's so important for your workplace, it's super important for your relationships at home and all the relationships that are going to be important to you. And I just want the best for you. And this is a big issue. And I've seen it as a pattern in your life. And honestly, you've probably seen it in mine from time to time. Can we just, like, for the next few months, can we really try to work on this together? Like, that's a great way for our kids to know that we are with them, that we are for them, and that they can see a model of our growth right alongside our correction of them. Another common heart issue that comes out of our pride is the demand for a good reputation. And so on the way to an event, we make sure our kids know they need to behave. And during the event, we might correct a little more quickly. And after the event, maybe we are upset with them because of something they did embarrassed us. We really want them to do well because it reflects on us. And our kids know that's not about them. Our kids know it's about us. Demand for good reputation can lead to family secrets and other things too that are just really, really unhealthy. It's amazing how much power and control our image can have in our lives. Like, look at David, a horrible sexual sin against Bathsheba. But he murdered to cover it up and save face. I mean, that might be an extreme example, but I mean, we all need to step back and ask, are there ways in which we are parenting that are really more about us just trying to preserve our reputation than really what's healthy for our kids? Oh, there are so many other issues. Love and appreciation, demanding our kids should appreciate what we do for them, and when we don't, we get a little ticked. Or maybe it's the opposite. We're afraid to lose their love, and so it's hard for us to set the right boundaries and correct when we need to. Or maybe it's a love of pleasure, what leads to an out-of-balance life where we spend too much time, you know, in things that aren't that don't matter as much, or we spend too much money there. Maybe it's orderliness, right? I mean, you all know what that's like. Some of us, things have to be in order for us to be okay. And so we get a little reactive when kids leave things out or don't clean up after themselves. Or maybe it's success, my success, which leads to too much time at the office. Or maybe we put high pressure on our kids for success, and they've really got to do well in school, and they've really got to do well in sports. Maybe it's materialism, and we've got that side hustle going to try to get ahead. And it takes the time away from really building into the lives of our family. There are so many issues I could put up here, and each of them look a little bit different depending on the person and the context. So when we find ourselves not reacting in a healthy way as a parent, let's not blame our kids. Let's step back and say, God, what's going on for me right now? And I can't imagine any parent in this room that can't relate to some of these things. And our initial tendency might be to beat ourselves up and self-condemn. Don't do that. It doesn't help anything. God wants us to lean into his forgiveness and use this as an opportunity for growth and change. And it's never too late to do that. Even in our 80s and 90s, we have opportunity to model growth and to build into the relationships with others and our extended family. Well, as we close up here, I'd like to ask you to consider two things this week. First, which of these demands of the heart can you relate to the most? If you don't know, ask your spouse, or if you're not married, ask a family member or friend. If you've got kids, ask them, they'll know. And then step back and ask God to begin to do a work in your life to really grow you and change you in that area. And then I challenge you to take some time to reflect on Zephaniah 3:17, because the best way to become a person after God's own heart is to know God's heart well. Take time to reflect on the depth of God's love for you in those beautiful images from Zephaniah 3:17. Consider that that same beautiful love is towards your children, towards the other significant people in your life if you're not a parent. Ask him to form that heart of love in you so that it would overflow onto those around you. As we close, I invite you to pray together with me. God, we want to be a people after your heart, to know you, to love you, to pursue life in you. We also want to be a people after your own heart in the sense that we want to reflect your heart to others. So fill us with your love. Thank you for the kids you've placed in our lives or other significant relationships that you've spoken to us about today. Use us in their lives. Thank you that you're with us and that you are for us, even when you're correcting us. And God, now as we turn our hearts to sing and worship you, I pray that you would continue to help us see the depths of your love and your grace more clearly. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand together and respond.
Straight.
Our prayer team, care team will be up front if you'd like somebody to pray with. And if you'd like to find ways to connect better here at Calvary, head right across the lobby to our connect team there at the Overlook. Well, the battle's the Lord's, which means the best way for us to fight as parents is to fight on our knees. I encourage you to pray the prayers of Scripture for your kids. And I would like to close today by praying one of those prayers of Scripture over your children, over you as parents, and over all of you, whether you're a parent or not. In the words of Paul to the Philippians, "And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God." May God be at work in your life to that end. Amen.